Hi everybody, thanks for tuning into this curator's talk hosted by the State Library of New South Wales. My name's Jeff Barker and I'm a curator at the library. Today I'm going to be talking about the Australian Antarctic Expedition and the collections acquired by the library between 1923 and 1947, which relate to that trip. And in particular, I'm going to focus on some of the photographs that were taken. But before I start, I would just like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which the library now stands, the Gadigal people, and to pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. The library holds over 4,000 items relating to Mawson's Antarctic expedition. These include diaries, drawings, maps, as well as thousands of photographs taken by over 20 photographers who were on the trip with Mawson. Frank Hurley is probably the best known of these, but he only took a few of the photographs and was only at one of the three locations where the expedition set up camps. Currently, I'm looking at a lot of these photographs to try and establish more precise dates and geographical locations for them. I'm also working on a series of stories looking at the roles of the other photographers that were on the expedition aside from Frank Hurley. Hurley has received a lot of attention, but the other photographers were all scientists except for a few of the members of the ship's crew who took photographs, and they had a very different view of their time in Antarctica in some instances. They also were on sledging trips and at locations which Hurley didn't get to visit, and so provide a very unique view of the Australian Antarctic Expedition. The Australian Antarctic Expedition took place during what's commonly referred to as the Golden Age of Antarctic Exploration. This was really between the years of 1900 and 1920. And during those years, the continent was visited by Scott, Amundsen, Shackleton, of course, and numerous other international expeditions. The Australian Antarctic Expedition, which arrived in Antarctica in early 1912, was the first Australian-led expedition. The area that Mawson had chosen was directly south of Australia, and once there they were going to conduct a series of scientific tests, for atmospheric tests, magnetic tests, and also do sledging trips to do surveys of the coastline around that area which hadn't been explored before. They also had a base which they were going to set up at Macquarie Island, and this was going to be a transmission station so that the expedition would be able to use a telegraph for the first time to connect between the Antarctic continent and Australia. After getting approval for the expedition and arranging some of the finances, Mawson headed to England, where he purchased an old Newfoundland whaling ship, which they renamed the Aurora. He also brought some Greenland huskies to act as sledging dogs once they got to Antarctica, and picked up two members of the expedition, Xavier Mertz, who was a Swiss ski instructor, and Belgrave Ninnis, who was a English officer, to mind the dogs. The image on the left is taken by F.J. Gillies, who was the second engineer on the Aurora, and here you can see the dogs on board the deck of the Aurora. The image on the right is also taken by Gillies, and on the far right you can see Ninnis. This has obviously been taken while the ship was experiencing some fairly rough conditions on the way to Australia. There was some urgency in making sure all of their plans were in place by the end of 1911. One of the main reasons for this was that all of the Antarctic expeditions needed to leave during the warmest months of the year before the ice froze over, and navigating through the ice packs became virtually impossible during the winter months, and even during the summer months it was extremely dangerous, particularly as it was heading towards winter. So at the same time as Mawson was arranging this expedition, Robert Scott and Amundsen were engaged in their race for the South Pole, and in fact Mawson and the expedition were on the continent at the same time as Scott. So the Aurora made its way to Hobart, picked up the rest of the members of the expedition, and they were ready to leave by the 2nd of December and headed off south for their first stop, which would be Macquarie Island, where they would build a transmission station and then head further south to land the other parties on the continent. In this picture on the left, we can see Captain Davies at the bridge on the 2nd of December, just as they're leaving Hobart, and this image was taken by Xavier Mertz. The image on the right is taken from the bowsprit of the Aurora, and this one was taken by Frank Hurley as they were heading down towards Antarctica. Looking through the collections, it seems that there were a lot of different photographers taking photographs on the way down to Antarctica. The image on the left is another Hurley image, and Hurley took with him four Graflex cameras and a stereoscopic camera that had been used by TWE David in Antarctica before him. He felt that both of these cameras worked very well in the Antarctic and the cold conditions. The image on the right is another one by F.J. Gillies, and this is of the ship's rigging on the Aurora ice dover as they're heading down to Antarctica. And of course, one of the issues for all of the photographers, and as I was saying before, there's about 20 different photographers. They all had a variety of different cameras, and each of the expeditions had both plate and film cameras. But you had to be careful how many you took and where you took them. Obviously, taking a lot on the way down wasn't such an issue for the people on board the ship, but for the other members of the expedition, they didn't want to use up all of their film before they had completed the expedition. Their first stop was actually at Macquarie Island, but I'm just going to skip that and I'll come back to that at the end of this talk. But the second place that they stopped, and the first on the Antarctic continent, was the main base, which they set up at Cape Denison. After traversing the ice pack and getting closer to the continent, the Aurora spent some time trying to look for a location. But finally, on the 19th of January, they found a spot where they would be able to set up at what was called Cape Denison. And they set about building the accommodation there, and the picture on the left, which is by Frank Hurley, you can see them adding the extension workshop to the living hut. All of this was prefabricated material that had been shipped on board the Aurora and was put together on site once they arrived. When they arrived, it was quite calm weather conditions, and they felt they had chosen a good site, but it turned out that it was actually one of the windiest places on the continent. And after they built the hut and the telegraph station, they then experienced some very, very heavy winds and blizzards, which caused them to be locked inside for a lot of the time that they were on the continent. And the telegraph mast that they built was blown over. They had lots of problems with the telegraph trying to establish contact with Australia, and in fact in the entire first year they weren't able to contact Australia. The picture on the right is actually by Douglas Mawson, and it shows Robert Beige, who was in charge of the magnetic and tidal readings outside the transit house for taking astronomical readings. As it turned out, the conditions at Cape Denison were so bad that most of the time was spent inside the hut. Even just going outside to take readings could be a very dangerous excursion. They had winds up to 241 kilometres an hour at times, blizzards and visibility there was very difficult. And according to Hurley, he said they had only 10 absolutely calm days throughout that year of 1912 to 13. And he says that on the 1st, 2nd and 3rd of September, he took 82 shots and around 2,000 feet of film. So a lot of the pictures that we do have are at a particular location at a particular time because of the conditions. And this is particularly the case for those people at Cape Denison. The image on the left is taken by Archibald McLean, and it shows Hunter and Hodgman and Beige doing washing up inside the hut. On the right, we can see Hannam, who was the wireless operator, and you can see the telegraph machine there. It had, as I say, problems communicating with the transmission base at Macquarie Island almost for the entirety of the year. And one of the reasons was that it was set up in the workshop where it got very cold and didn't help the equipment. One of the stranger things that the expedition brought with them was the machine they referred to as an air tractor, but which was really the frame of an aeroplane with an engine. It actually had very little success using this during the course of their stay. It kept breaking down, and Bickerton spent a lot of his time working on it, trying to fix it. The wind and the terrain made it very difficult for it to be used, and you can see in this picture it even looks like someone's helping push it through the snow. That photo was taken by Charles Lazarin, another member of the team, while on the right there's the picture of the ice mask, and you can see just how cold it must have got there. And this photo was taken by Xavier Mertz. You can see where the holes are formed around the nose and the mouth, where there's enough heat to melt the ice. A major impact of the poor weather was that Mawson wasn't able to organise his sledging expeditions until really August of 1912. Frank Hurley was the main photographer for the expedition, but clearly he wasn't able to go on all the different expeditions. So other photographers were responsible for a lot of the material that was taken on these trips. One of the other things that's interesting to note about photography on these sledging trips was that they tended to take images on glass plates on the way out, because they could leave them at the depot and take the lighter film negatives towards the end of the trip and then come back and pick up the glass plates at the depot as they returned. The images here on the left is one by Xavier Mertz. It's of Douglas Mawson next to one of the sleds. And on the right is a self-portrait by Frank Hurley next to, obviously, a much smaller sled. There was, however, one sledging expedition which had a major impact on the Australian Antarctic Expedition, and this was the Eastern Sledging Party of Mawson, Minnis and Mertz. Mawson's Eastern Party left with another party from Cape Denison on the 10th of November 1912. They travelled for a while with that party, and then after they'd separated, continued on their way east. On the 14th of December, which was a beautifully clear day, they were traversing across an ice plateau. Xavier Mertz was in front on skis, and behind him was Douglas Mawson on a sled, and Belgrave Ninnis was on the third sled. In the journals that Mawson kept of the trip, it doesn't really explain why they stopped, but they felt that something was wrong, and when they looked behind, they couldn't see Ninnis anywhere. So they retraced their steps and found that Ninnis had fallen down a crevasse after going over the same ice bridge which they'd all travelled, but obviously his heavier sled had caused it to break and he'd disappeared down the crevasse. Mawson and Mertz both tried to yell down into the crevasse to see if they could hear any signs of life from Ninnis, but the crevasse was extremely deep, and after a while they realised that Ninnis was most likely dead. This was a terrible problem for them. Not only was the loss of one of their great friends, and particularly for Mertz, who had come from England with Ninnis, and they'd both been very close friends, this was a great personal shock, but also the sled which Ninnis was driving was the main sled. It had their tent, it had a lot of their food supplies, and it also had some of Mertz's protective clothing, they realized that they would have to turn back and immediately start making their way back to camp, which they did. But along the way, Mertz's condition rapidly declined, and as they ran out of food, they were forced to eat the dogs. And this was something that must have been very difficult for Mertz, who had looked after them from the time they'd come from England, and also brought up some of them, the new pups. He'd looked after them and nurtured them as they were young. The dog food, some people have said that the livers had caused them to kind of have a, eating too many dog livers had caused their decline in health. But there was also lots of other factors. There was just the fact that they were in extremely cold condition. It was unseasonably cold summer that summer, and Mertz, without his protective clothing, was obviously at risk. And it ended up that on the 8th of January, Mertz died in the tent with Mawson looking after him. And this meant that Mawson was left alone to return back to base. And just to note that these two images, the one on the left is of Ninnis driving a sled with a team of huskies, and on the right is a picture of Mertz on the edge of the ice cliff. The picture of Mertz is taken by Frank Hurley, but we're not sure who took the one of Ninnis. It's one of the few unidentified photographs in the collection. Mawson, Mertz died on the 8th of January 1913, and it would take Mawson another month to make his way back to Cape Denison. He cut his sled down in half to make it easier for him to drag back, and he was obviously living on very meagre rations and was in a very poor condition by the time he made it back to Cape Denison. The Aurora had arrived on January the 13th, 1913, to pick up all of the explorers at Cape Denison, and it had waited for Mawson to arrive before it left. But finally, on the 8th of February, it decided, Captain Davis decided that they couldn't wait any longer as the ice was starting to freeze over, and they still had to pick up Wild and his men from the Shackleton ice shelf. And this meant that, in this incredible twist of fate, Mawson arrived back at Cape Denison on the 8th of February, just hours after the Aurora had left. At the camp were Madigan, Bage, Bickerton, McLean, Hodgman, and a new wireless operator, Jeffries, who had volunteered to stay for another year in case Mawson returned. They tried to contact the Aurora, but unfortunately, Captain Davis thought it was too risky to return, and so Mawson and the rest of the men were left to spend another year on the Antarctic continent. While we've been looking at events that happened at the main base at Cape Denison, there was a second base on the Shackleton ice shelf, and we'll have a look at some of the photographs from that base now. After leaving Mawson at Cape Denison, the Aurora sailed west. On board was the Western Party, which was made up of eight men under the supervision of Frank Wild, who'd travelled with Mawson on Shackleton's expedition in 1907 to 1909. They finally chose a site on the 15th of February, and this was after the Aurora had been locked in the ice and time was running short for them to make a decision on where to stop. So rather than stopping on land, they actually decided to set up their camp on the tongue of an ice glacier, the Shackleton Ice Shelf, which was sticking out into the ocean. The decision to make a camp on an ice shelf had one very obvious drawback. And you can see that in this photograph on the left. This was taken by Andrew Watson, and it's a view of them hauling up their stores from the Aurora onto the top of the ice shelf, which was about 30 metres above the sea level. And so it took nearly 5 days for them to lift 12 tonnes of stores up onto the top of the ice shelf. The image on the right is of the Aurora anchored off floe ice, presumably fairly close to where the image on the left is taken, but this was taken by Frank Hurley, and it must have been taken in 1913 when the ship was returning to pick up Wild and the rest of the members of the expedition off the ice shelf. Conditions for Wild and his team were better than at Cape Denison, and there were less winds and blizzards. But by April, the hut had already frozen over, and to get around the problems of getting in and out of the hut, they decided to build a series of tunnels under the ice around the hut. And this series of tunnels they nicknamed the Grotto. The image on the left is by Archibald Hoadley, and it shows the entrance to one of these tunnels at night time. The image on the right is a view of the hut before it had been completely snowed under, and this was taken by Andrew Watson. The photograph on the left was taken by Hoadley and shows the tunnels underneath the entrance that we could see in the previous picture. This was also where the dogs spent most of their time when they weren't out sledging. The image on the right is of the entire party, all eight of them, so we're not sure who took the photo, but this shows them when they were returning after a sledging trip. Because conditions were better on the Shackleton ice shelf, Wild was able to send out more sledging trips. And in October, they decided to send out everybody on sledging parties because the weather was now good enough for them to be able to do some longer trips. So only Moyes was left behind at the base. Harrison, who went with one of the sledging parties, was supposed to return in a week, but because that party lost the sled, it meant he had to stay with the sledging trip all the way through. And this meant that Moyes was left at the base for 9 weeks alone, thinking that Harrison had died. And he later described this as the worst time of his life. The image on the left is taken by Frank Wild, and it is on one of these sledging trips. It shows them breaking up their camp. And the image on the right shows Wild's sledging party returning to the grottos in late 1913, and that photo was taken by Morton Henry Moyes. The final place I'm going to talk about is the camp that was set up at Macquarie Island for the wireless transmitter. Macquarie Island was actually the first stopover of the Aurora after it left Hobart, and all of the expedition disembarked here and helped build a transmission station on a site on the top of a hill, which they later named Wireless Hill. The image you can see here is a panorama of Wireless Hill by Leslie Blake. It's actually stitched together from three separate photographs that Blake took while he was there between 1911 and 1914. The main reason that the five men were left at Macquarie Island was to look after the telegraphy and the transmission station that was set up there. They had to build it from scratch, and they hauled all of the equipment and the building materials to the top of Wireless Hill in December of 1911. They needed to build this transmission station because they were using long wave transmissions at this time, and it required a lot of power, and there wasn't enough power that they could generate in Antarctica to deliver a signal all the way to the continent. So Macquarie Island was really a key part of Mawson's overall plan. In the image on the left, which was taken by Xavier Mertz, we can see McLean and Mawson on Wireless Hill. And this must have been taken in 1911 when they were setting up the station. On the right is a picture taken by Frank Hurley, and it's of a wreck of a ship and obviously the penguin colony on the island. Of the five men left on Macquarie Island, Sandell, Blake and Hamilton were all keen amateur photographers, and they took many pictures while they were there over the following 2 years. While telegraphy was the main objective for the setting up of the camp, while they were there they also took meteorological measurements They surveyed the island and took a lot of notes regarding the natural history of the island. These two images are both by Harold Hamilton, and they, on the left we can see the Sandy Bay hut, and on the right the Lusitania Bay hut. And these huts were set up over the island to enable them better access to the different wildlife that they were observing at the time. When they were finally picked up in November 1913, they had spent nearly 2 years on the island. On the 13th of November, the Aurora left Hobart and arrived at Cape Denison on the 13th of December 1913 to pick up Mawson and the other expedition members who had stayed the extra year. Frank Hurley was on board for this trip, and he took photos all the way through on the way down and on the way back, and he used these to augment the material which he had already taken. Mawson finally arrived in Australia in February 1914 after spending the extra year on the Antarctic continent, and this delay had several significant consequences for the expedition. Mawson's primary concern was getting all the data collected by the scientists published in the official reports, and he needed to raise money to do this. On the plus side, the extra year that he had spent in Antarctica saw him establish the first telegraphic communication between Antarctica and Australia, which they had failed to do in 1912. But it also saw Mawson with time on his hands to write what would eventually become his personal account of the expedition, Home of the Blizzard. Mawson's most pressing problem was the need to raise money for the reports. And photography had been a key part of his planning to pay for these reports, and that was one of the reasons there were so many photographers on the expedition. He knew that he'd be able to use his photographs for lectures and publications and to give to newspapers to help raise funding. The key factor, though, was Hurley's film footage, and Mawson intended to sell this to Hollywood to raise more money. Arriving a year after he intended to, and after all the rest of the expedition members, was a problem in terms of marketing the expedition. But in 1914, Mawson arranged a deal with Hollywood producers to make a film with Hurley's footage. Unfortunately, the timing couldn't have been worse, and on the very day that the deal was to be signed, Britain declared war on Germany, and the producers backed out of the deal. Financial problems dogged Mawson, and it wasn't until 1942 that the final report was published. And this is actually one of the reasons that the collection is now held at the State Library of New South Wales. The state government of New South Wales stepped in to help Mawson with finances to produce the publications on the condition that he donate the photographs, the maps, the natural history specimens, and the equipment that he had collected from the expedition to the library. The natural history specimens and the equipment was later transferred to the Australian Museum and the Museum of Applied Arts and Sciences, but the original photographic negatives and prints and the maps are all still here, held here in the library, and are now one of its more treasured collections. Well, that's the end of this talk. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much for tuning in.